Well, good morning everyone. Sunday, 3rd of September. And look at that. Nice and sunny, blue skies. Why couldn't we have just had 6 months of that? I don't ask for much, do I? So, I'm not hungover, which is a surprise because I was out watching the match last night with the wife. Absolutely disappointing. Anyway, it gives us a chance now to get some sort of prep done on the pond. I don't even want to mention the word winter, but I need to get some of the sort of deep cleaning done. So that's what we're going to make a start with today, while the weather's good and allowing. Let's just have a quick look at the temperature. It was lovely yesterday. It got up to 22 degrees when we were out. Not bad for about 10 o'clock in the morning. So I've just had the net off the pond. I never used to have a net over mine, but after watching so many of the YouTube videos and hearing koi jumping out, herons, predators, me being away all week, it just put it in my mind, so I have been using it lately. The downside to it is you've always got to roll it off back when you want to do anything internal in the pond, like brush the bottom off, which I've been doing now. You'll see there's the attachment off the vacuum. Just been in there, give everything a good brush towards the bottom drains. It's hard to see for the glare on the water. Now, what I'm doing, just this sieve connected to the skimmer, so I'm just giving the skimmer lines a good purge. You see, letting that just come through full flow, give that a good rinse out. Right, I'll just turn this 4-inch valve coming back off the Draco drum. Which then feeds the clean side of this. So yeah, that's going to equalise out now, and we'll go and do the same with the other one. So we'll just take this lid off. See, just a bit of build up of crap come through the skimmer. Just so I can do this. To remove the screen, give that a good clean up. Let's see, lots of crap in there. Give that a quick rinse round and I'll get back to you. Right, so just give that a rinse round in there. So all I'm going to do now is close the 4-inch return from the drum filter. Which will then, as you'll see, it'll just put the skimmer into full pull once the pump empties that chamber out. And then we'll just see what comes out of there. So what's been lingering in the bottom. Churn up. We'll just allow that to pull clear, and that'll be that one done. Alright, now this one should be pulling clear now, so all good. A little bit of a leaf, get that out. We'll stick the mesh back in. And that one done, good to go. Still some stuff lingering in this one. Let's help get that out. It hasn't been the best summer, but the fish have been feeding quite well, so they're producing a lot more bits of old food, crap, the type of stuff you'd expect. So it's important that we do use deep cleans periodically, get your pipe work, it's best you can get it cleaned on the inside. Right, that seems to be pulling clear now, so we'll just do the same again. Open the flow back from the drum filter. Just let that equalise out, put the mesh back in, that one's good to go. It's just occurred to us that obviously I've got that many forms of filtration on my pond. It's funny when people ask us, say, Mark, what system you're running? And when I go in through it all with them, they sort of look at us like I'm mad. I thought it'd be good to show people the different filters, because when I first started out, I had no idea what a sieve filter was, a drum filter, how the Nexus filter worked, sort of. So if I go through a few of them, it might help people out with making a choice on what to put on their system. I think that'll be a good video to go with. So yeah, let's just, we've done the sieve filters, you've seen us clean them, but I'll show you the basics of a one now. So mine, I have two of them hidden in these little wooden boxes. Hello big girl. They are connected to my skimmer. See there. So the skimmer skimming in into the sieve. These are the Ultra Sieve 3. So, the pond is low at the minute, so the water in here is low, because I have been doing cleans on the Nexus. But there, so from the skimmer end through the mesh end. Now mine don't work as a normal sieve would work, because I also feed from the clean end of the drum filter, as you've just seen, in the clean end of the sieve. So this always normally equalises to the same level as the pond water. And then from there, mine are pumped out on this side into that Nexus 200 at the back. That one we'll go into later, because it's just something slightly different. But as you can see, quite simple mechanics on these. Water comes in from the skimmer. It would normally rely on the level with this weir. So see, the level will rise now to where the adjustment of the, there's a balance in the bottom of this, which depend on how much water your pump draws away from this clean chamber, allows how much of this comes in, and then it equals out, gets itself to a balancing point. So that's how that works normally. So mine, because it feeds in clean from the drum, it's always a level of equalization. And the, basically the skimmer just pulls a nice pull in, it's just enough to keep the scum off the top of the water. It just helps me utilize one pump here, which operates the bottom drain and the skimmer, and then sends it up to the biological stage at the Nexus. So that's an Ultra Sieve 3. I've adapted mine to suit my circumstances I wanted. But that shows you that. Right, I'm just going to get these hatches put back down, and then we'll look, quick look at the drum filter, which is the Draco Drum Solemn 25. Right, that's the hatches back down. I've just left that air pump out for now, because I'm going to take the lid off it and clean the filter out today as well. So we'll just need to slide this table forward now. There we are. Access to the Draco drum, run by a timed switch box, which is all my pumps, air pumps. Very handy them, especially for the air stones that I've got in front of the skimmer. It's have them on a timer, so they come on just 5 minutes before the food goes off on the Pro food feeder, or the auto feeder, and gives the fish a chance to eat everything before the skimmers just take it. So very handy, very easy to set up. Draco drum, the Solemn 25. Right, basically it's hard to show you. Bottom drain. Both of them come up here, feed into this dirty chamber. That's just the dirt in the waste chute. They need cleaned out. So dirty chamber into the, what do we call, the mesh screen of the drum, goes through there. And you have your drum. As you can see, this one's dirty at the minute. So the drum is full. I've got it switched off, I think, at the minute because I was doing something, but let's have a look. Yeah. Take it a wash. Just got soaking wet. You see there, all of the muck going down the teeth. Okay, so you just seen that once the wash was triggered, basically the drum rotates, the jet washers on the top there just blast all of the crap that's gathered down into the central chute, which then just goes to waste. Mine is just simply plugged in to go straight down the drain waste there. So what we have, for those that don't know, the water on the dirty side is always going to be the same level as your pond. Basically equals out to the same level as the pond water. This side, because the mesh gets blocked up, the pumps draw the water away till it empties, which there's these little float switches, and if that goes down and touches and makes a connection, there. You get another wash cycle. Now that that's completed its cycle again. So, Draco drums. Excellent bit of kit. Very small footprint for a drum, which is why I purchased this particular model. It was easy for me to hide, as you've just seen underneath the garden table. It's in a nice area I can easily maintain and get to it, so that was the reason I chose this model. One downside to it, that float switch. Nothing wrong with the float switch, but these pesky little buggers, your pond snail, which I'll just get him out because he'll cause us no bother, tend to get themselves lodged in it. So the switch will be up, the snail will be inside, the chamber will empty, the switch will go down, but can't make a full connection because there's a bloody snail trapped in it. So that's my only downside with this bit of kit. Every so often it's failed to trigger because there's been a snail stuck in the float switch. But I hope that explains the drum filter a bit better to you. Highly recommend them. If you have a lifestyle like mine, where you're not around the pond much, you need someone at home to obviously look after the pond for you. But if you're not here to do your regular maintenance, this bit of kit here is a lifesaver. Me working away from home a lot, with work obviously, it keeps things running smoothly for us. Okay, so we've just looked at sieve filters, either side, drum filter. So remember, to recap, 4-inch bottom drains, one each side, to the drum filter. Drum filter splits off, goes to the clean end of each sieve filter. Skimmer goes to the dirty end of the sieve filter. Skimmer goes to the dirty end of the sieve filter. Now this sieve filter, those who watched previously know that I did an adaptation to it, so it now comes off the sieve filter, gets pump. The pump is hidden down there, just hear it humming away there, pumped off there, We then made a DIY upflow filter. Easily done. That goes to a shower filter, another DIY job. Shower filters. I didn't really need one. I just needed to pull more flow out of my 4-inch bottom drain line. So to do so, I couldn't send the full flow of the 20,000 litre pump straight into the Nexus 300 because it would just be too much flow for that filter. So should be mine. Goes pumped into the Nexus 300, leaves that by gravity round the back. Gravity feeds the Nexus 200. Gravity feeds this holding tank. Comes out of the holding tank, down pipework into the large Bucky River system, waterfall and return. So yes, I didn't need one, but I put one on so I could get more pull and flow through my 4-inch bottom drain lines, which will help stop any debris building up in those lines. 17,000 litres is what I should be pulling through those lines. I'm closer to it now. I still don't think I'm actually there, but I'm closer than I was. That's why I still have to purge my 4-inch bottom drain lines. But apparently shower filters, great for removing nitrite, the bacteria that grows in them. It's supposed to be a really good job at the nitrite cycle, actually removing the nitrite. Downside to them, people don't clean them enough internally. If you're going to use them, do something like I've done, a pre-filter on them first, like the upflow filter, and make sure nothing gathers inside of them, which will give you bacterial issues, water parameter issues. Make them easy to get access to and clean, or and pre-filter them well. So, just sticking with this leg of the system, as I said, pumped from this sieve to that pump. When we get to here, we either go straight up into the pre-filter, the upflow filter. So a little bit more about them. I simply made my own. Pumps up. I have a valve there, which I could, if I shut that valve, everything gets diverted straight to the big Nexus 300. With the valve open, it splits between the two. So you can see, water comes in, hits the micro K1, all little bits of crap and fines get stuck in there, gives you clean filtered water, comes out the top, which goes to my shower filter. So the alternative is it goes up, pumped all the way under the decking, out from the decking into the Nexus 300. Let's just say, in the Nexus 300, I'm rocking the Easy Center filled with Micro K1. People have seen Nexus clean before. I've done it loads on my channel. I'm not going to do it again today. Now, this is something a bit different. We leave the 300, it wraps around the back of the quarantine tank and just gravity feeds the 200, because the 200 is smaller than the 3, so naturally the water just finds its way through the system into that one. In there, we use this old school Nexus foam centre. It's a big blue block of sponge normally when you buy them new. Now, I do this because basically I had Nexus stuff from my old ponds, from old properties. So, I said before, paid a lot of money for them, not going to get rid of them. What I can do though, in between them two pipes, I have a 4-inch ball valve, currently closed. So when it's closed, the water has no choice but to use that route to that Nexus. Should I open it, it goes straight the easiest route to the Bakke River under the deck. Why do I do this for? Said I had the filter, might as well use it. Then I thought, quarantine tanks. Quarantine and hospital tanks. You need filtration on them. You need a filter to be what I call a live filter. It's got live bacteria in it. It's been running. Trying to start one up from new every time you've got a problem or an issue just proves it difficult in its own way. So this way, when I isolate the system and either go from full pond running, which it is now, or just quarantine only, that filter has always got live bacteria in it and it's good to go. So that's why I did that. Unfortunately, if I'm in quarantine, I have to knock my shower filter off. I haven't got a way yet to keep that going in the system when I'm running a quarantine. But as I don't really need it, and it's only there to help us with extra flow from the 4-inch bottom drains, so I can use the bigger pump, it's not too much of an issue for us. So I hope that explains upflow filters, shower filters, Nexus filters, quarantine setups. Much advised. Get a new fish, quarantine them, scrape them, hospital tanks, we went into this on the last video, new use of heat and salt, works wonders. Right, just to once again fully understand this leg of the system. So 4-inch bottom drain, skimmer, 4-inch bottom drain, drum filter, skimmer, sieve filter, drum filter, skimmer, gets pumped from the sieve up here into a Nexus 200. Yes, I still need to get a lid for this filter. Anybody knows any cheap Nexus 200 lids going, let me know. We are rocking the Easy in this one with the Micro K1 in. Currently nothing in the outer chamber. It is my plan to put some static media in there should I need it and when I get some, but at the minute it's empty. I'm not running another air pump on there for no reason when I don't really need it. The main biological side of my filter is handled by the two Nexus over there that you've just seen. This basically again is just help pull the flow from the pond. It then pre-filters all the water after a drum filter, but it still gathers crap because the skimmer line comes into this as well, just before, to protect the Bakke River so that doesn't get totally filled up with crap, because I don't clean that out every week. More or less once a month we'll have a look in it. Okay, so Nexus filters. These are the older models. There's new model Nexus now, but I've had these for a lot of years. But this is the 300 one. Let's just do a quick dive into what that's about. For anyone who hasn't got a Nexus or is thinking of getting one, might help explain a few things. Okay, so lid off. Mine is a pump fed Nexus. Basically, pump is under pressure, coming in to the inlet. As you can see, pump round there, water goes round this inner chamber and has to make its way through this dense, which I say is the micro K1, is the media I use in the inner chamber of mine now. I can get away with this because this follows on after a drum filter, so it won't blog up within a week. It's the drum filter handles the most of it. This is basically just the biological stage. It has a use of following on after a drum filter, a Nexus filter. If anything goes wrong with that drum, say it breaks, or let's say I'm putting treatments in the pond and I want to just bypass the drum, the water comes straight from the drum, bypassed, be it, whatever, and just goes through a Nexus as it would normally. So there's some contingency there for me. If the drum filter was to break, it's a mechanical part, it can happen, moving pieces, then I can just go back old school, straight to the Nexus filter. If I've got fluke treatments in, where I don't want to take out the water by the drum, bypass the drum, straight into the Nexus filter. That's a contingency for me and why I run my system the way I run it. But the basics of a one, dirty water in, has to get through the media collects all the crap. The cleaned water then goes through the central chute into your outer ring, which has your normal, I just have normal K1 bubbling away in there. It then goes through this grid, there's a stainless steel grid here, and into an outlet back to your pond, or in my case, feeds its small little brother over there. So there, very easy to clean. I'm not going to clean it today. All I need to do, the top there, you turn it, the air stops in the outer chamber. You grab one of these, put it down in the inner chamber, bubble all that up, disturb all the crap, then basically open the top to waste and that chamber flushes out. I say, people have seen Nexus 3 years now. Okay, so we've been through two legs of the system. Bottom drains, drum filters, sieves, both go off in their own direction, pumped up. One pumped to that Nexus. This one pumped to the Nexus, to the up-pro filter, the shower filter. By the time it goes through that whole system, either way, it returns under here to the final stage of my filtration, which is a DIY Bakke River. So, purpose of a Bakke River. They're really good for getting rid of nitrite. So, there's a certain bacteria, I never remember the name of it, somebody will know it, probably Skeggy. Always helps us out with these things. The bacteria doesn't like a heavy saturation of oxygen. So, where water moves quite slowly through medias, it colonizes those medias, so it isn't as disturbed as the oxygen in your, say, your Nexus outer ring. So we put some media in the system. It comes, so we're fed from the Nexus on the far end, fed from the Nexus on this end. First chamber, Lotus media, whatever it's, complimented, proper name for it. You'll recognise it. Lotus, mountain tree lotus, something. Anyway, it's a housing for beneficial bacteria. Second chamber, biohouse media, normally found in shower filters, an old vortex stuffed with that in the central chamber. Water makes its way around the media, nourishes the beneficial bacteria, removes nitrite. Nitrite, that's right, I always get them two mixed up. Leaves that chamber, enters an old biotech 10 filter that I had. As always, I modified that to suit the purpose I needed. That just acts as a final stage pre-filter before the waterfall. So it's the final return. Anything that's managed to make it through the system should get caught up in those six sponges. These are the videos I've done that shows this in more depth, but basically that is the final stage of my system before it returns to the pond and the waterfall. Now, the last piece of kit that gets my water looking really good and crystal clear is a UV filter, an amalgam 80 watt submergible UV, which is housed inside the chamber of the waterfall there. It's stainless steel plate in there where the bulb shines on the hot spots to protect the plastic of the filter of the waterfall, and so far it's done a great job. Anyway, if anybody was interested, that was an old terrapin tub that I bought off Facebook Marketplace. Somebody was getting rid of it. I clocked it, realised it would make a great waterfall return for my pond when I was undoing the project, and I don't think it did too bad. Cost me about £40. Cut the edges off it, nice little stainless steel trim on the bottom, and it become the waterfall you've all become familiar with. So, as you can all see, a lot of filtration there. Is it all needed? Absolutely not. Would I change it? Absolutely not. The engineer in me just can't stop improving the system. And it's mostly what I enjoy, as well as keeping the fish and having this beautiful water feature in the back garden. All the messing around with the engineering, plumbing, pipe work, making the system work for you. As I've said before, that's a massive part of the hobby for me also. So let's have a look at what all that filtration gets us. We always run very steady water parameters. I will mention at this time though, it doesn't matter how many filters you have, nitrite will always spike with feeding. It takes the filters time to catch up with the new feeding regimes in the summer, no matter how many you have. So don't fool yourself into thinking that the more you add, you can eliminate that nitrite spikes, because until the bacteria build up on them, it doesn't matter how much houses or homes you've got for that bacteria to go to, until they build and colonize it, it's not there. Let's have a little look at the water and the fish, and we'll see where we're at. Thank you. Well, as you've just seen, nothing matter with that clarity. They're all looking happy enough down there. You're always going to get the odd bits of algae and stuff breaking off the side, which ends up in the water. But as far as finds go, I'm quite happy with that. If I can get that pond looking like a HD OLED TV, them colours popping through the clarity, and that's what I try to achieve. Most of all, fish are happy, content. It's getting on now, Sunday evening. I think the thermometer must be broke because it's reading over 30 degrees now. Must be a little sun trap here. The sun does set in that corner, so that's probably what that is. I'm going to have a beer, chill out before we go back to work tomorrow. So, thanks for watching. This one went on longer than I thought it was going to go on, but that's just what happens sometimes. Do us a massive favour. I'm enjoying coming back on YouTube again. A bit of encouragement. Let me know you're enjoying what I put out. Like, subscribe. It means a lot. Bye now.